Hi, I'm Robert Osman, co-writer, co-director of the film Hard Tide.
I'm Kat Gellin. I'm the producer of Hard Tide, and I also play Kim in the film.
I'm Nate Wiseman, the co-writer, co-director, and bald guy in Hard
Lead
Tide.
Lead actor.
Yeah, that's it, yeah. We did a short film together. I was just an actor, just popped in for your graduation film.
Yeah. And then we come up with this idea, and then it
snowballed into a monster that we could not kill. No. I was supposed to go on another film. I just come off this feature film and did this short film. And then when I came away from Margate, I was like, yeah, there's something there. And I just bored everyone around me saying, we've got to go back, and this could be the starting of something. Like the starting of a beautiful relationship. No, but like the jumping off point. And then I met up with Rob and took him to TGI Fridays and got him giddy on ribs and JD and Coke. And then he was like, yeah, all right, I think that's a good idea. And then we started, just threw ourselves into it. Like, there was no... We weren't even...
No, we just went for it.
Had you actually graduated at that point, or are you still...
I graduated in May, so we were writing the script. As like...
So, yeah.
And then, like, 3 months later, wasn't it? We were pretty much in the trenches looking for furniture to furnish a flat that we hadn't acquired.
Like, the day before our shoot... me, Rob and his granddad drove to Panelux to pick up all the lights.
West London, yeah.
While Kat, our lovely producer, who was there just pulling stuff.
Pulling strings.
Just everyone out, like, you know, can you do something? You can help out. What can you do? We were up at like 5 a.m. We came in and there's this room full of people like, thanks for coming. Yeah. Wow, I'm amazed you're here. That's amazing.
Yeah. The crew all turned up and we just got back, and then we did a little meet and greet, and then...
And collapsed, and then went
shot the first day.
When we first met, we just talked about the films that we liked and the films that we would love to have been involved in.
British cinema, yeah.
But things like London to Brighton, Kneel by Mouth,
anything Shane Meadows,
Dead Man's Shoes, and just like saying, how do you do a film that we could get out there and just do for like next to no money? We thought we were originally going to make this film for nothing. Like, we just took a loan out and we went out and we're like, right, what can we do? And then we just hit the streets.
Pretty much. There's a film at the time that stood out for me was a British film called My Brother the Devil.
Yeah.
Sadiel Hosseini. I'd just seen that and I remember thinking that was quite well done, and I liked the theme, and she brought different themes into it, and she sort of, it was just a really well made film. And then we mix that with the London to Brighton's, like the low budget British cinema, gritty, not a happy ending type films, like Kneel by Mouth, like
all those films had a lot more money than us, though, just to be clear.
Yeah.
I play a guy called Jake, who is he's grown up in care, and he also lives on an estate in Margate, the Millmead estate. He's not a bad guy or anything like that. He deals a little bit to make money. He's kind of fallen through the system a little bit. Like he didn't have like a proper, what people would say the traditional education route is or whatever. His dad is a bit of a known criminal in the area.
Yeah.
And he, yeah, but he's not a bad guy. He's just
he was a hustler, wasn't he?
We were really conscious about like showing. I mean, there's been a lot of different like gangsters and drug dealers portrayed on screen, and we were like, well, how can we do it a bit different? We don't want to make him like some hard man. And
I also play Kim in the film, who's Jake's girlfriend date. I don't think their relationship's quite defined. Kim's from a very different background than Jake is. She lives in a nice house. She's sort of, you know, more middle class, doesn't live on the estate. So they're sort of divided from the word go, really. And I think, you know, she really cares for him, but they haven't known each other that long, and she obviously sees very quickly that he gets embroiled in something much bigger than himself. So she tries to help him out as best she can. So nice character to play, particularly me being Norwegian, you know, putting myself into the shoes of someone living down on the coast, in England. It's nice.
We wanted Jake to morally do the right thing in this film. Yeah. And that was really the jumping off point for us as a character.
Even if his job, you know, is morally dodgy, but he doesn't necessarily be... He's got a good heart. He isn't like a...
Yeah, like he was selling... We wanted him to be in his business was dodgy, but when it came to doing the right thing with the girl, like at the starting point of the film, we felt that maybe for once he would try and do the right thing.
Producing and acting at the same time is hard. especially since I wasn't really meant to act in it originally. There was an actress that dropped last minute. There was a couple of actors that dropped last minute. And my role as a producer was very much in action at the time. But it's fun as well because it kind of keeps you on your toes. You have to, you know, put on different hats and it's good because you see it from both sides. You can sympathise with the actors doing their thing and you can sympathise with having to sort, you know, last minute problems out. So again, you know, it was very hard, but it was a good exercise. And, you know, it makes you a better actor, makes you a better producer, I think.
We took it slowly and then she just went with it. She's so resilient. And she just picked it up and she loved the crew and she's quite happy to just go with us, really, wouldn't she?
I think for us, we were trying to make it very like fun for her, but at the same time, to create this little bubble so she could get into character and sort of understand that we are telling a story. And, you know, there's a big responsibility working with kids. It isn't an easy thing to just like, go and no act. You know what I mean? Whereas sometimes on low budgets, you are just running around, running and gunning, like going, and now just fucking act.
And we did.
We didn't do that with her. We were really, and we had like chaperone, teacher, parents, loads of people on set around. And it's quite a hard-hitting thing for a 9-year-old to get her head around. So we had to take it, you know, just one day at a time and just describe the process as much as we could. But then we didn't want to give too much away. You didn't want to start into like tricking her into performances. So it's just trying to keep the whole thing very natural. And it's hard, but it's also when it works, you just get these nuggets of like amazing, honest, pure performance, which is... It's just a kid being a kid, and that's what I think gives the film the heart, really.
So basically, Andy Lucas comes in, and he was just he's a star. Like, he comes in, he's got the backstory in his head of what they've been through as father and son, and him and Mem got together, and they were having a chat, weren't they, in the florist, and then they come to us, and they're like, yeah, so this is what's going on, and even to the point where he borrowed the wardrobe, Chloe's jacket, and he put it over him, and he was like, "Yeah, this is going to be my dead wife's coat, but I wear it because it makes me feel good."
And I know, and stuff like that.
That's brilliant, and he took it to Mem. Mem jumped on board with it, and then we played the scene from there, really, didn't we? And it was just Andy Lucas did our job for us in terms of that, and then it was great. He was great with Alex. He really. So he's been around the block so many times with the amount of credits he's got, and I think
Way he works as well, he's just a giving so actor. Like, he doesn't, you know, there's a lot of, you do end up coming in on films and stuff, and you just, people sort of come in and get out, and it's like, you know, shoot me out, just do whatever. And if people come in and actually just like giving and gracious with their time and actually really chat to everyone and want to. They want to tell the story if they're there for the right reasons, which I think everyone in
all
the
cast was.
Yeah.
We did a Kickstarter campaign. And Kickstarter's, you know, real supporters of indie filmmakers across the world. And through that, we met some more of our backers. We had some incredible help from friends, from family, from people who just got interested in the film and got on board. So putting yourself out there, we created this video where Nate and Rob and Alexandra did a little plea. We had some footage from the short film. That's always really helpful because it helped get the message out there. It helped us meet some of our backers who've been with us the whole way, really. It's not easy for any micro-budget film to get out there. Any project with very little money, you're going to have to work pretty much twice as high. You don't have the marketing spend, you know, you just don't have the resources that a big studio has. So you're just going to have to work twice as hard as the filmmaker.
We shot in the hospital. It was a real working hospital. We managed to lag our way in there. Like Charlie, our line producer, Kat. Charlie and Kat Cash basically flagged our way in. Cash had got us there. We had to shoot on Sundays. So we shot our first Sunday there. It was fine. We did it all. And then we come back. And I remember, I think it was the producers were there before us because we were shooting somewhere down the road. And they'd knocked it down.
There's a slight and problem, just, guys. Like, oh, what?
They knocked down the
entire wing of the hospital we were shooting in. But no, that's ridiculous. Why would they do that? Why would they?
So yeah,
they had because there was renovation work going on at the hospital, and when we told them that we were doing it, they were just like, "Oh, we didn't know you'd need that to look
didn't
the
know
same."
You need it again.
We're like,
yeah,
no. So yeah. That was
an obstacle.
The whole way this film came about, and everyone, the genuine like spirit of it, and people getting involved and just coming out to just help us make this film, and if you got something that resembled a good scene at the end of the day,
every day, I was going to say the end of every day, thinking that we've actually gone, we've shot everything, whatever problem we had, we got over it.
I still got a problem. And we got really lucky with our amazing editor, PJ, and also Tom Houston and Vitali and Josh Cook, and Joe Mannion as well cut this at the beginning. Because we were just trying to assemble it as we were going.
To give you an idea, we started with Joe, didn't we? Because he DP'd the film.
Yeah.
And so we were like, assemble it so we can...
And then we're like, but are you sure you're going to be objective enough? And he's like, yeah.
So we start with Joe, and then we did an edit camp. We called it edit camp in January after the film.
Yeah.
Where they were a long 2 weeks. Kat came down sort of to
generously. And a place was donated to us by the amazing Jackie, who just let us go and have a house while she was away in Margate. So we just went back to Margate after taking a little break.
Yeah.
Came back with, and we moved the TV downstairs.
We were sat up there, in like a room.
Sat there in a room, just going bonkers for like...
2 weeks?
Two weeks.
You and Joe?
Just trying to, pick takes and go like, I like this bit, let's do that.
That's where we sort of assembled the rough bones of the film. Yeah. And then we went through a period of time where Joe had got to a point where, because he DP'd it, we knew that he couldn't go any further. So we then jumped on with Tom Houston, Josh Crooks, Vitali.
Tom was cutting at my house in London.
He cut for a very long time.
And he was great. He was brilliant. And each time the film was getting better and better, and you're getting like different sequences or different moments
and
out of it.
We got to a point with Tom where we thought we were very nearly like final cut, ready. Mm. And then PJ, I don't know how PJ, you met PJ, didn't you? It was
through someone.
And then, he said he'd have a look at it, didn't he?
And we just felt we needed, and also along the line, an amazing editor as well called Mark, who's in Ireland, in Dublin, was like looking at it and giving
Mark Galise,
who's like, Skyping us with suggestions and stuff. And then we started getting feedback. We had a couple of test screenings, and then we decided that we wanted to add a tiny little bit more, so we went and did one pickup shoot, and then we put that in, and then we gave it over to PJ and we started finessing bits. But it's a process. You make the film three times. You write it, you produce it, on the day, and then it's in the edit. And it is, each one of those things is an incredible, as important as the other.
Yeah.
But the edit, that's where it comes together, or doesn't,
The film was originally named after the short film, My Hero. And we decided to retitle it for the UK market. Several reasons for that, really. It's tough to sell any film at the moment. And the film Hard Tide, our distributors felt would resonate better with the public. Something about, the underdog, man against the system. It's shot on the coast. And something to do with the tide, that the inevitability of the tide coming and going. And unfortunately also the inevitability of Jake trying to do the right thing and possibly not going so well.
It is a luxury that we did get to go back, didn't we? We did a couple of days and just we spliced in some extra story that essentially made the film better.
Yeah, and also we wanted like some like second unit stuff with the amazing Charlie Jones to sort of add some production value, get a bit of aerial stuff in there and things like that. That
people, Adrian as well. Adrian gave some great aerial
because
shots.
We just didn't have time. We really, when we were making this, we were just in the trenches, just trying to get through. And we really thought this, you know, this film was going to be made for nothing whatsoever. Yeah. And we just kept going. We'll just see what we can do. You know, the house in the film where Jade's dad dies is Rob's mum and dad's house. You know what I mean? There's bits of the where the crew were staying were locations that we were shooting in. It was just a complete, you know, bringing it together. Yeah. There was
definitely.
Yeah. So the opening track is an incredible song recorded by an artist called Maiken, who Kat is friends with. She's an incredible Norwegian singer, songwriter, and she came in and, you know, we didn't have much music money to spend on music, to be fair. So we got her to record a song called Wayfaring Stranger, which is like a really out of copyright. beautiful song. And I produced the song and sang on it as well because, you know, I'm an idiot. And then we had an incredible score by Cy Begg, who was amazing, and we sat with him. And that was really exciting to sort of go in with him once we've locked the picture. And I think we might even change bits around and stuff.
That was the point where it became real, wasn't it? Because we were editing, but we hadn't brought in the music side.
We had so much temp music, which is awful because then you fall in love with like a song that you could never afford, like a Radiohead song. Like an incredible, you know.
We'd use placeholders for music. And then when we came to Sight, it then suddenly started to transform into this original piece, which was great. Clear Cut was really good as well because that was where we mixed it.
Yeah. Ben knew it was amazing at Clear Cut. And then we got really lucky with Mike Righteous, who's in the film as well, but just wrote this in an Oscar-winning, deserving song. It's amazing, like, and just was like, there you go, yeah, I did this for the film. That was one of the best moments. I remember being in a cab on my way to the grade, and we still hadn't locked the song for the titles, and they sent me the first
When I Fall.
Yeah, When I Fall track, and I was listening to it by myself in the car. And this taxi driver was like, "You all right, mate?" And I'm like, "Yes, fucking awesome." I was like, "What do you reckon to this? What do you reckon?" And he's just like, "Yeah, it sounds all right, mate. I don't know, yeah." I'm like, "Mate, it was just like that." And then I got there and I was like calling Rob, like, "You've got to listen to this. Can you hear it on your phone?" I was like, "No, I can't. Send it now. I just listen to it." And then when we got to the grade, and we were just like, "This is just, you know, we got lucky with stuff like that. I don't think you can plan that.
You can't. You can't plan it." And Mike Wright.
Well, you can plan it. You can plan everything, but we just didn't do that. Phenomenal. This is the only place this film in the entire world could have got made.
You know, it was the best possible place for the film to be shot. It's incredibly beautiful on the coast. There's a reason why Charles Dickens wrote his books down there. You know, Turner came down to paint there. So it's picturesque. It's beautiful.
What we found in Margate was nothing but support from the locations, the ones that stand out. Emma Campbell at the forest.
Yeah.
She gave us the whole forest for literally just said, come in, do what you want. Morena and the girls. There was local people who gave us the houses and stuff. And
they helped us out with locations. They helped us out with their time, with their efforts. It was just great reaction from day one, really.
The guys that were like two buildings down from where we were shooting, like, were like, "Oh, you're in the film? Can we be in it?" Yeah. And so we shot bonus footage with them, and actually it turned out to be like some of the more realistic stuff we did, because you just can't
fake
no makeup artist and that, like, you just can't, like, they were just real.
The makeup artist and the art department are claiming all credit for that, so just be clear.
So the film's been long listed for two Biffas. It was Best Newcomer and Best Actor for Nate Wiseman. So that's obviously very exciting. The premiere was absolutely packed to the rafters. I think they actually bent the rules for us to get people in, which was great. And it was just really fun. We had some incredible people turn up, and I think it really, you know, it helped us gain some momentum in terms of distributing it and selling it and doing all of that. We basically got into Raindance Film Festival in London, which was a real stroke of luck. So that was our sort of opening screening. And through that, we met Metrodome and Aldemisa, who are then distributing in the UK and selling abroad, respectively. So Raindance was a real game changer for us.
But we just wanted to make a good film and treat people right and not actually have some crazy hierarchy where I think we've both been experienced sets or shoots where people have got a bit shouty or things have got a bit silly, and we just wanted to try and keep the whole thing as fun as possible because we couldn't pay people enough to make them there for the money, so we had to just have fun. This is going to be fun. Honestly, you're working 20 hours, 50 hours a day, whatever, breaking time. So we just had to, we wanted to make it fun and also that we wanted everyone invested in that they would actually feel that they're a part of making something that they'd be proud of as well, because we are proud of it. The film is never as good as your dailies, but never as bad as your assembly. Ooh.